tales for dark nights.
Knuckle Supper. Written by Drew Stepek. Performed by Jason Hill. Chapter 29. Salt Hands. Eldritch and I huddled behind a big rock in front of a wasteland of abandoned mobile homes, while Eldritch jerked his head in all directions, making sure the coast was clear. I fidgeted and panted, feeling the dog blood and speed course through my veins, electrifying my heart and brain. His unsteady finger pointed to the compound, about a mile away, that was surrounded by a 6-foot brick wall. At all four corners were skinhead mules with AK-47 machine guns slung over their shoulders. At the entrance was a guard station set up to secure the once prominent gated community. Beyond the gate, at the center of the colony, was a clubhouse surrounded by several crumbled homes and rusted trailers. They keep all the drugs in the country club. They sleep and socialize in the trailers and houses. I'm guessing that Dez and Copperhead are in the stucco ranch home. He pointed off to the left side of the clubhouse. And I believe your friend is with them there. It appears to be the most fitting home on the property. Unnecessarily annoyed, I put down the archaic scope because I could see better without it. Where did you meet with Dez when you came here before? Eldritch's head jerked and twitched, the speed eliciting him to tug on his own hair. We met in the clubhouse. With his claw, Eldritch began unsteadily mapping the area in the sand. I scratched the side of my head. How the fuck do you expect us to get in there? I mean, Jesus, how can we get through undetected by the guards? God damn it, Eldritch! I felt like there were sand fleas crawling all over me. I'm going to drive directly up to the front gate and be let in. While I create a diversion for the guards, you're going to edge around the back, climb the fence, and make your way down the backside of the silo. I chewed on my cuticles and scratched at my cheek. Boy, speed was a hell of a lot different than my cherished heroin. Are you fucking crazy, Eldritch? As soon as you drive up there, they're going to rip you into 1,000 pieces with those machine guns. He sucked his clove down to the filter. I smelled the burning plastic. It made my nose itch. Not likely, RJ. They want me to participate in their new business. They have to know that you saved me at the Opera House. That place was filled with snitches. Fucking snitch cripples. I felt like I was moving 1,000,000 miles an hour doing nothing. Like I was running on my knees, full speed down a never-ending hallway. Trust me, not one person is telling these Philistines anything. My presence at the Opera House is known, trusted, and respected. Besides, I must get the hearse into the compound. All my weapons are concealed inside the casket in the back. Using his talon, he drew a circle around the outskirts of the gated area to establish the mountains surrounding the valley. Before he finished the circumference, his steel nail fell off from all his trembling. We'll use the dark cover of the mountains behind us to advance behind the clubhouse. As you can see, that area is much closer to the back gate than it is here. He marked an X on the ground, representing our current position with another one of his claws. I tried to focus on the mountains circling the skinhead invasion valley. The horizon tunneled inward and outward, making it difficult to judge the depth of land directly in front of me. Ignoring the racing of my heart, I acknowledged that he was right. The range spiraled inward to the back of the clubhouse. The only way into or out of the basin was the route we took, that was filled with the deserted dwellings of the Salton Sea. I don't know about this, Eldritch. Like you said, this is a complete suicide mission. If we're going to do this commando, let's just bum rush them straight up. You know, do you know what the fuck I'm talking about? Do you hear me? God damn it, can you hear me? He grabbed my shoulders and shook them. We cannot back down now. Our destiny is to save this young woman. We have to do this right or we are dead. This is so cheesy. Out of nowhere, I felt an object belt me on the back of my head. Ow! I yelped, deciding at first that it was nothing more than the overdose of speed in my system. I looked down at my chest cavity. The center of my body expanded and collapsed, trying to keep pace with my heart. Slobber whizzed around me everywhere as I flapped my head around, releasing my jowls. Another object smacked me in the back of the head, driving my face into the rock formation in front of us. I shoved Eldritch. He fell back on the scope. "Why are you pushing me?" He picked up the pirate looking glass. It dangled around, broken. "This cost me a fortune. I pushed you because you just nailed me in the back of the head, asshole. And who cares about that stupid thing? It doesn't even work." A Caribbean twang sang out from behind us. "So, I guess Diz was correct in thinking that you weren't dead, eh, RJ?" We both spun around. Copperhead and three Desians stood on top of one of the busted-ass airstreams behind us. Arrogantly, Copperhead flicked dust off his shoulder. "Good thing we're out hunting. Dez is going to love this." He picked up his cell phone and began dialing and pointed to Eldritch. "Eldritch, come on, RJ. Why bring this pussy?" Before I had the chance to leap into a brawl, Eldritch dropped two smoke bombs in front of him and screamed, "Mine!" He pounced toward the trailers on all fours, unintentionally knocking me over the rock with his back leg. He rocketed toward them, bolting his massive body into the war zone. Without missing a beat, Copperhead jumped and met him mid-flight. Rather than be bothered with a collision, Eldritch simply grabbed Copper by the head, spun it around like a baseball, and pitched him further back toward the mountains. I got to my feet and bounced in Copperhead's direction. Eldritch descended directly between two of the Desians. A thunderous boom rang out as the Uber Vamp's boots landed on the aluminum trailer. His talons dug into each of their skulls, locking in securely as if they were bowling balls. Not wanting to be the next victim, the third Desian jumped off the trailer, trying to escape. Viciously, Eldritch scooped the scalps, brains, and spines out of his first two victims, and then one after another, fired them like meteorites across the desert, tripping up the fleeing Desian. I made my way back to the canyon wall where I expected to find Copperhead. Eldritch clearly had those three covered. Rumors of his pacifistic demeanor were grossly misinterpreted. That was the most barbaric display I had ever seen. At that point, I wanted to join his gang. Like a jackal in a spin cycle, I leapt from trailer top to trailer top, looking between the openings for Copperhead. I smelled his pot stench everywhere, but the speed made it increasingly difficult for me to hone in on an exact location. Bubbles blew out of my nostrils as I tried to slow my heart. An intense vibration grappled onto my body and carried me around like a Mexican jumping bean. "Focus, RJ," I kept telling myself. Tree limbs crackling, rocks rolling from the cliffs, and random pops in my bad ear came at me from every direction. As I made my way between the two last trailers, I was hit by a tree branch and lost my footing. I flipped backwards, hitting the edge of the trailer. I slid down the side, catching a railroad spike on my back that was being used to cover a window with wood. The ragged skewer bumped up my vertebrae like a playing card, clicking through the bike spokes. I felt it breaking bones in its path, until it reluctantly stopped on my recently healed shoulder bone. "Fuck!" I wailed. I steadied my palms flush against the airstream and released myself from the spike. I stumbled to the next trailer, checking to see if Copperhead was above me. I didn't know if the tree I whacked into was his doing, or if it was just my exaggerated alertness that was blinding me rather than servicing me. He wasn't there. I scurried around the maze of campers, looking for a way out. I shook around my jowls again as mounds of spit whizzed everywhere. The dryness of my eyes was killing me because I hadn't blinked since I shot up. A wave of twitching transferred from one of my arms to the other and then back, and my fingers contorted like they were all independently trying to escape from my hands. I clenched my fists to try to stop the disobedient behavior, only to notice the blood vessels from my elbows to my wrists popping out and collapsing. There were sand fleas all fucking over me. so I tried to scratch at every inch of my flesh. Finally, I made my way out to the boundary between the trailer maze and the open air. I looked over at Eldritch, who was tugging organs and innards from the fresh carcass of the third Desian. I looked at the top of the trailers and saw Copperhead. With long strides, he skipped over the top of the aluminum graveyard. Rather than bother with me, he made his way toward the unaware Eldritch, who was squeezing an intestine to his mouth like a beer bong, trying to siphon what little blood was left. I immediately began galloping like a quadruped toward the scene. What was left of the discs in my back slid around and separated. With not even a second to spare, I hurtled my frame at Copperhead, clipping his legs before he started his descent on Eldritch. We hit the ground while Eldritch continued to feast, paying our scrimmage no mind. I snorted away as the combination of rot blood and meth continued to pull the strings, puppeteering my body and mind. I sunk Copperhead's face into the sand, beat in his cheekbone with my knuckles, and kneed at his annihilated ribcage. He spat sand and weeds out of his mouth, trying to create a passage. "Okay, okay!" He cringed like a tabby cat. I remained relentless, breaking him open like a piñata at his center with my leg. I shifted my knuckles to my forearm and clubbed him so hard in the face that his nose became an indiscernible blob. His eye popped out of the socket and dangled from the spaghetti behind it. A clear fluid dripped from the jumbled ball. The phony Jamaican accent magically disappeared.
"Please stop, RJ. I'm sorry, man. I'm so fucking sorry. I didn't do anything. It was Dez's idea. It was all Dez."
It was too easy to just let him go. I thought about Herman and the downfall Copperhead had plotted against him. They force-fed us to the enemy and handed Herman a pink slip at the hands of the cloth and the habit. I relaxed on the chest cavity and pinned his thighs down with both knees. I felt his pants fill with piss and shit.
"Please, RJ,"
he pleaded. He begged just like the tranny and the bus driver had, but I wanted to see him suffer. I was excited to kill him. I tried to grab a breath and looked up to Eldritch, who was still paying no attention to us. He continued his fixation on the organs of his casualties.
The whore,"
Copperhead stammered. I placed my fingers around his skull cap and rotated his head out of the sand.
You want the whore, right?"
I didn't answer. I grinded my teeth, panting every few seconds.
"Come on, RJ. Please let me live. I'll take you to the whore."
He closed his intact eye and tried to inhale, hoping he would suck the other one back into the socket. His actions reminded me more and more of Herman. He was a cheap imitation of a great man.
"RJ, she's alive. I never touched her. It was Dez. I had nothing to do with it."
He tried harder to inhale. The eye slowly started to move. Halting his attempt, I snatched the eye and shoved it into his mouth.
"She's alive?"
I asked. Copperhead nodded, not sure what to do about being able to see the inside of his own mouth. "Well then, I have no need for you, motherfucker. This is for King Cobra." I fastened his head down in the sand behind him. He squinched his eyelids closed and bit into the eyeball in his mouth. With a powerful uppercut from my free hand, I compounded his chin all the way up to the middle of his face. I dug in farther, making his skull wrap around my fist like a boxing glove. I pulled my arm back for a moment and then plowed directly through the center of his cranium, spray-painting his brains all over the sand. I stood up, still breathing ravenously, and pulled his head off my fist with my boot. Eldritch peeked over his shoulder at the mess.
"No need for you to do me any favors, RJ. It, does not appear like he was much of a contest anyway. Look over there, though."
Eldritch pointed off in the distance to Copperhead's black Cadillac Escalade. I reached into the front pocket of the former Battlesnake's jeans. Sure enough, the keys were there, and we had our ticket into the compound.
Good evening. This is Jason Hill, host of the Horror Hill podcast. You've been listening to a chapter from the award-winning novel Knuckle Supper by best-selling author Drew Stepek. Knuckle Supper, Ultimate Gutter Fix Edition, and its critically acclaimed sequel, Knuckleballed, are available now from Bloodbound Books. Check out the links in the video description and sticky comments below to pick up a copy today and show your support for indie horror. Also, please consider making a donation to Children of the Night today and help end teen prostitution and human trafficking. Children of the Night is a privately funded nonprofit organization established in 1979 with the specific purpose of providing intervention in the lives of children who are sexually exploited and vulnerable to, or involved in, prostitution and pornography. Visit childrenofthenight.org for more information today. From author Drew Stepek and all of us here at Chilling Tales for Dark Nights, thanks for listening and for your support.
Chilling Tales for Dark Nights.